Amen. And so we got to work, we're going to work that out. But happy Mother's Day. Amen. 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 Charge into our head and not our heart. Amen. Hallelujah. If you have your Bibles, I won't be before you long. I'm going to fill in the rest. Amen. 1 Samuel chapter number 2. 1 Samuel chapter number 2. And when you have it, I would like to. 1 Samuel chapter number 2. And when you have it, say amen. I would like for you to stand. Amen. Hallelujah. 1 Samuel chapter number 2. 1 Samuel chapter number 2. Verse number 26. Amen. 1 Samuel chapter number 2, verse number 26. Amen. 1 Samuel chapter number 2, verse number 26. Amen. And the child Samuel grew in stature and in favor both with the Lord and men. I'll fill in the rest. Father, we bless you. God, we praise you. We honor you, God. We lift you up. We magnify your name, God. We thank you, God, that as some preachers say, the grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of the Lord will stand forever. And so, God, we lift you up. God, we say, have your way. We bless you. We praise you. For there is none like you. Have your way in this place, God. In Jesus' name, amen and amen and amen. Amen. You can be seated. Amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Mm-hmm. Listen, I want to tell you, amen, before I move into this next part. I just want you to know, I know we've been talking about stuff lately, about this building, about finances and all that other stuff, but that is not our goal. It's just an end to a mean, amen. Amen. We're talking to you about it because that's where God is calling us to go, amen. And so be praying for us. We'll be praying for you, amen. But I wanted to talk to you for just a few seconds about this verse of scripture. It says, and the child Samuel grew in stature in both favor, both with the Lord and with men. Amen. It's an interesting thing that we find this verse of scripture because I wanted to talk to you for just a second about it. It's interesting to me that in the Bible, you had every woman, because of the scripture and because of the testimony, it said that the seed of the woman would bruise the serpent's head and crushes his head, but the serpent would bruise his heel. Amen? And so ever since that scripture came out and Adam and Eve fell into trouble, every woman was looking to birth a deliverer. Amen? Whether it was a male or a female child, most of the times in the scripture, sometimes it wound up being a male, but every now and then it wound up being a female, but everyone was looking to birth that promise, that promise. There is a promise that the Lord gave to the man and the woman after the fall of man, that when they had a child, that that child would one day become great. It would become greater than what the enemy was trying to do in their lives. Amen. We find that thing in Revelation, that when the woman was fighting against the enemy, that the enemy got weirder and weirder, but the woman got stronger. And so every woman was looking to birth something that came after her that would end the suffering of her generation. It's not enough just that you have a child. What happens is that a lot of people, we want the child to grow up to be better than we ever were. Amen. the real purpose of a father and a mother is supposed to be that they want the child to grow up and see first. It's one of the reasons why fathers would often put their children on their shoulders, or why mothers would put their children on their shoulders, because the vision is that when you're on the shoulders of your parent, you should be able to see further than they ever could. Wow. And so we have, as it were, shoulders maybe. So everyone was looking to push out the deliverer. And when we have, in this verse of scripture, God had it happen that you have a woman named Hannah. And the Bible didn't go as far to describe all the things about Hannah, but how many of you know that, I don't know why they had it, but Hannah was married to a man named Elkanah. And Elkanah had two wives. I find it strange. I don't know why a man would want to have two wives. Amen. Beautiful, or all that other good stuff, but I think the real purpose of a man, that's what I'm trying to get across to my children, it's not how many women you have. It's whether you could take one woman and make her happy for the rest of her life. Amen?
Amen.
And so the real goal of a man is to love and to support and to protect. Amen?
Amen.
But Elkanah had two wives. One name was Hannah and one name was Panona. And the Bible says that every year, Panona would become pregnant and Hannah would not. And how many of you know that anytime you have a Hannah and a Panona in the same place, then there can be some trouble. And the Bible makes it clear that Panona would often tease Hannah because Panona was pregnant and Panona was giving Elkanah sons and Hannah could not. And how many of you know that sometimes every woman has to have, every man will have their own Panona. Panona comes to distress you. Panona, that situation comes to irritate you. It comes to hinder you. It comes to remind you of the failures in your life. Has anybody ever had any Panonas in their life?
Yeah.
Panona comes to remind you that you are lacking in an area. Panona is always talking. Panona is always telling you that you're never going to be enough. Every person, if you're honest about yourself, you'll have a Panona in your life. Well, Panona was telling Hannah all the time, reminding her, I got a son, I got a son. You don't have no children. I don't. And so she caused Hannah to believe that her husband loved her less because of what she couldn't give him. And oftentimes, I need you to understand this, that it grieved her. It grieved her so much that she was burdening her spirit. Has anybody ever been haunted by the things that you felt like were far off from you? Have you ever felt like that sometimes God was just dangling a blessing over you and it was far off from you? Have you ever felt like that the thing that you desired or the thing that you needed from God, that they were just so far off? It was close enough for you to reach forward, but not close enough for you to grab it.
Mm-hmm.
Am I the only one with the issue? Has anybody ever felt that way?
Yeah.
Has anybody ever felt like the thing that you were reaching to God for was close enough for you to see it, but not close enough for you to touch it? I don't know if I'm talking to anybody. I don't know. But sometimes we feel that way. I felt like at times, and I'm like, God, why would you show it to me if I can't have it?
Mm-hmm.
Why would I see it if I can't be it? Why would I get so close enough to it till I can smell it, but I can't taste it?
Mm-hmm.
And oftentimes those things seem to be far off from us. And so Panona kept teasing Hannah.
Mm-hmm.
She kept teasing Hannah about the things. And so finally Hannah began to pray.
Mm-hmm.
And see, and here's the thing about your situation. Your situation sometimes, the Lord will allow things to happen and he will allow it to seem like you're going through a barren season. Anybody ever felt like they're going through a barren season?
Yeah.
A barren season is a season where you're supposed to be giving birth to things, but everything around you seems to be drying up. A barren season is it seems like there's a time when you're supposed to be having water, but everything around you looks dry. It's a rain season with no rain. Are you hearing what I'm saying? That was the case with Hannah. And the Bible says that Hannah, she became so grieved in her spirit that Hannah went to the church. And she went to the church and she began to pray. But let me explain to you why all these things was happening. You see, at the same time, the children of Israel was going through a situation. How many of you know that sometimes your barrenness or sometimes the things that are far off of you is not because of anything you've done? You see, the children of Israel at the same time, while Hannah was going through her barrenness, was going through a situation. And the situation they were going through was that they were surrounded by crooked priests. They were surrounded by crooked leadership. And anytime leadership is crooked, it automatically causes the people who submit themselves to the leadership to suffer. Children of Israel were going through a situation where they couldn't get their sins remitted. And here's the reason why. You had Hophni and Phinehas, and you had Eli, who was the chief priest at the time. And Eli and Hophni and Phinehas were sleeping with the women in the church. Mm. It's scripture. I ain't gotta make that part up. They were doing all sorts of things, and they were taking the offering, they were taking the fat of the offering, and they were using them for wild parties and you name it, this and that. And when the people came and it's in there, and they confronted Hophni and Phinehas about it, they lashed out at them. They did all those other things. And how many know that the people were feeling like they couldn't get their sins remitted? And so they begin to cry out to the Lord, God, send us a deliverer.
Yeah.
And oftentimes God will hear the prayers of his people and God will send an answer.
Amen.
It's strange sometimes because God does strange things. And I always tell people that if I could understand God, I don't know if I would really serve him if I always understood why he did what he did. And so God closed the womb up of this woman. She wanted to have a baby so bad she can taste it. Mm. How many of you ever wanted to have something or ever wanted to get something, ever wanted to receive something from God so bad that you can taste it, that it tormented you? You wanted something so bad that it tormented you, that you wanted, and people would often remind you that you didn't get it. Well, you know, you should be married by now. You should be, when I'm going to get some grandkids, you should have this by now. You should have that by now. You should be a millionaire by now. You should have this business by now. You should have that by now. You should, and everybody's going to tell you what you should have.
Right.
And it's not enough that they were telling her that, but she began to internalize that thing for herself. But one of the things she did was that every year, mm-hmm. they would go up to the church, and Eli would give a portion mm-hmm. to Hannah, mm-hmm. and she would give a portion. He would give a portion to Penona, not Eli, Elkanah, a portion to Penona. But the portion that he gave to Penona had to be a little bit more because he gave it to her so that she and her children could offer it to the Lord.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But Hannah was greedy. And Eli came up to him and he said, baby, you know I love you. He said, aren't I better than you than 10 sons? And what she said in her tears was, no. I want something from the Lord. And how many of you know that when you want something from the Lord, sometimes it will cause you to go through drastic measures. Mm-hmm. And so when they went and they offered, they looked around for Hannah, and Hannah was nowhere to be found. And the Bible says that Hannah was in the church and she was praying. I came to tell you one of the most dangerous things that you can ever find on this planet is a praying woman.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Is a praying person, period. But Pastor Paul, I told me this one day. He said, Pater Herman, he's being honest, but he, you know, sometimes his S's don't really, you know, I'm bad with my TH's and my W's. He's pretty bad with his, you know, his T. He said, Pater Herman, I said, yeah. He said, if I ever have a job that's too hard to do, impossible, I send a woman. I said, oh, wow. This brother has been arrested several times. He said, because women don't relent. They don't give up. They see, they do, or they die. He said, they want, they do, or they die. He said, they will stay until nothing else left. No, he did. He said, they will stay. He said, they fast, they don't eat, they do whatever. They will stay. They will get everything they got. They will take everything, and they will come back. He said, if I got a job too hard, I send a woman.
Mm-hmm.
Said that. Same man said, Pastor Herman, if it's God's will, it's God's bill. God's way, he pay.
Yeah.
I love that. I gotta send Pastor Paul out something. Listen. So listen, but here's the thing though. She stayed in the sanctuary
mm-hmm.
and she prayed.
Yeah.
And she prayed 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 and she cried and she cried and she prayed. And finally, Hannah came up with a solution. And Hannah was praying so hard that they thought this woman was drunk in the temple.
Mm-hmm.
Eli, I guess he wasn't used to praying in the spirit or whatever, but he came and he confronted her about being drunk. And she said, no, I'm not drunk. I'm grieved and I need something. How many of you ever know that? And she began to pray. And she made a prayer that changed the face of things. And this is what she said. She said, God, if, watch this, you give me a son, I'll give him back to you.
Yeah.
See, God had closed up her womb because God had something in mind. And what God did was God made a statement. He says he wanted her not to just ask for just anything. I don't want it just a regular son, God. God, I make a deal with you. If you give me a child, I'll give him back to you. And that is a mother's dilemma. Oftentimes, mothers get so desperate sometimes about their children that they'll pray. You have not lived, ladies and gentlemen, until you know the prayer that your mother has for you.
Yeah.
I wish every child could hear that. I wish every child could just come in a room one day and just catch their mother talking to God about them. I wish every child, two things I wish. We did a count. I wish every male could stand in a room and look at their wives through a mirror and see how much sometimes their actions tear that woman down. And I wish every person can come in a room and hear how their mother prays for them. Listen, you have not lived until you've seen a mother fighting for her child.
Yeah.
You have not lived until you've seen a mother praying for her child. You have not lived, and even if they're not praying, you have not seen or felt the grief that a mother feels when a child gives them the heartache. You have not seen the lengths that a mother would go through for her child. I don't know who I'm talking to, but look, if you got a mama, I promise you, your mama is something. She might not get everything right.
Mm-hmm.
Hear me. Sometimes she may nag you. She may get on your nerves. But I promise you, your mother is praying for you.
Mm-hmm.
I promise you that those things that mother is telling you, she's telling you because she's feeling you. She knows where God is. God will begin to work. You grew inside of her.
Mm-hmm.
Why wouldn't she be thinking about where you're going to be in your future?
Mm-hmm.
9 months she carried you. As my mother would say, growing inside me, no charge. You know that song? Everybody. Oh, I think my mom and my grandma used to make me feel good today. For the nights I sat up with you, doctors, who I prayed for you, no charge. For the night food and clothes and for wiping your nose, there was no charge, son. When you add it all up, the real cost. My mom used to say, for my love is no charge. But how many of you know that a mother, she prays. Listen, she grieves. She listen, when everything ain't right with you, I'm telling you, it cost your mama something. I've seen mothers crying and just grop, please help my child. Please help my child. Lord, help my child. Help my child. They're not ready. They're not on their knees yet. They're not what you called them to be. And I know, God, there's greatness on the inside of that child. Are y'all hear what I'm saying? And I feel like I'm a mother's advocate or something like that. Listen, my mom, same way. My mom used to growl for me. I'm telling you. My mom used to pray for me. Look, when I decided that I was going to stop going, my mother knew what God called me to be, and she prayed that thing in.
Yeah.
My mother was the ultimate encourager. Now, she slapped the snot on me now, but I'm telling you. But my mother was the ultimate encourager. My mother encouraged me. She talked to me. She did all those things. Listen, when you got a mother,
yeah,
and I'm the one talking to you, but your mother loves you, and your mother will do anything for you. Look, moms, sit the child down and let them listen to the message, okay? I want you to listen to this right here, because Pastor Herman got something to tell you. Look, to the day my mother died, my mother has always believed in me. Listen, I can't even think of how to explain it to you. But if you got a mom and she's still on this side of the earth, you need to honor her. Listen, you need to honor her. I know she may not be right all the time, but I don't know why this one wasn't even part of the message, but you need to honor her. Listen, Hannah prayed, and Hannah said, God, if you give me a son, I'll give him back to you. I want that son to be somebody that will give you glory. I want that child to be a leader. I want that child to be this. I want that child to be that. And so, and here's the thing. Hannah, God blessed her because Eli asked her, was she drunk? She said no. And Hannah brought the child to her. She
She had a child. And a few years later, she brought the child to him. And I don't know, but earlier when I saw it, I had a picture of Alizé. Like she was bringing her baby up, and you know, and she bringing the baby before the Lord. That's really what it looked like. It's literally what it looked like. And can you imagine having your child and bringing him up to the Lord? No, now she had more children after that. God opened up her womb. But bringing your child to the Lord and giving him to the Lord and leaving him there. Something that you prayed for. And that's what she did. She gave her child and she left him. And she went away knowing that she made God a promise. So listen, every woman has made that at some point, has done something like that to God. God help my baby. And what happened was God gave her a son. She gave him back to him. And I need you to understand this, but the child Samuel grew. She named him Samuel and left him in the presence of the Lord. Ladies, I understand you praying for the Lord. Your child, I understand sometimes you got to talk to him and sometimes you come across as nagging. But one of the best things you can ever do, you don't have to leave him there physically anymore, is bring your child before the Lord and leave him there. God, I give you this child. God, he's talking back and everything. They drinking, smoking, cussing, doing everything they want to do. God, I give them to you. Being disrespectful in class, I give them to you, God. I give you my child. Mm-hmm. She gave him Samuel. Amen. And I need you to see something. That every time she came back, she noticed something. Samuel grew. Mm-hmm. Do you know what Samuel's name literally means? It means his name is God. Samuel's name means his name is God. Mm-hmm. And so I need you to catch something. All the while the children of Israel were struggling, his name was growing.
Amen.
In the house.
Amen.
The children of Israel were going through struggle. They were going through turmoil. They were going through conflict. But the name of the Lord was growing in their midst. Hallelujah. They still had problems. They still were having issues. But unaware to them, the name of the Lord was growing in the middle of their situation. Come here, Isaiah, real quick. Come here, Isaiah, real quick. Both of y'all, come here, real quick. Come here. Oh, I got two ideas. You come into that. See, one year she may have came back, and the name of the Lord looked like this. Yeah, he's getting stronger. But the next year, she's older. One year he comes, and the name of the Lord looks like this. Yeah, she's getting stronger. And she's growing up to be all that she's called, that the Lord called her to be. But listen, you keep praying. You keep praying. See, because the name of the Lord is growing up in the midst. See, maybe a little while later, she'll come back. And the name of the Lord may look like this. But don't worry. It's growing. Mm-hmm. It's growing. It may not be strong enough yet to solve the issue in the house. But the name of the Lord is still growing. Mm-hmm. All you got to do is keep praying and keep praying. And keep praying and keep believing and keep fasting. Come here, Brother Paul, real quick. See, because the name of the Lord is growing in the house. Mm-hmm. See, sooner or later, the name of the Lord is going to look like this. You see, you hear what I'm saying? You see, because while you're praying, ladies, while you're praying, gentlemen, I need you to understand that God gave you something. God birthed something through you. And that thing that God birthed through you, God is not going to let that go if you keep praying for it.
That's it.
You keep believing God for it, no matter what you see.
Yeah.
Listen, you keep believing that what you taught that child is going to grow up and it's going to take root. Because scripture says this. If you train up a child in the way he or she should go, that when they're old, they will not depart.
Amen.
And that child is going to one day grow up to be strong enough. They may go through some stages. In the middle, they may cut up. They may act a fool. I'm not saying that you're doing that. You may cut up. You may act a fool. Grades may drop. All that other stuff. In the middle, they may find out they're cute. They good looking. And they might find out that they're growing through all these changes. But how many of you know that the name of the Lord is growing on the inside of them? What you put on the inside of them is growing. And one day, it's going to come up. And it's going to do what you called it to be.
Amen.
Right around here, they may affect cities. But by the time they get to this age, they affect the nation and they affect the world.
Amen.
So you never know what they're going to be.
That's right.
That's why you can't let go when God shows you something in your child. You got to begin to pray. And for some of you, it may not be a physical person that you're birthing. For some of you, it may be a business. Mm-hmm. For some of you, it may be a dream. Yeah. For some of you, it may be a career. For some of you, it may be something else. But do not forsake what God has impregnated you
Amen.
With. Are you hearing what I'm saying? For some of you, it may be many different things. For some of you, it may be your spouse. For some of you, it may be whatever. But God has given you something to birth and to push out.
Huh.
Push it. Believe God. Believe God for it. Believe God for it because your Samuel is growing. Don't you dare give up on what God told you.
Yeah.
I don't care what you've experienced, what you faced,
That's
what
right.
somebody told you, what somebody told you wasn't going to happen.
Yeah.
If you are believing God for something, continue to believe. No matter what you see, if God told you something, God will fulfill it. Listen, he who began a good work in you will complete it until the day of redemption. Listen, if God told you something, I don't care what anybody tells you, you believe God for it. I got several people in my life that God has told me something about, and I refuse to let go until I see it.
Amen.
I refuse to let go by faith until I see it. I'm going to have to circle around the wagon. I'm going to have to come to him and talk to him about different things, but God told me something. And I'm going to birth it. Listen, I wasn't going to do this, but honey, can you, I'm gonna read something to you. The other day, I got two letters. And I let Brother Paul read it yesterday, and we laughed. And hold this, my hand. I'm kidding. Honey, I want you to read this one, and I'll read that. Well, I'm going to let her read them. The first one I read, I cried. The second one I read, I cried and I laughed. Yeah, read that one first.
The first one says, the day I came to this school, I didn't think I would have someone I could look at as a father figure. Every time I need someone to talk to, I came to you. When I needed something, I came to you. And when I'm feeling down, I run to you. You inspire me to do good no matter what. That's why anytime anyone needs help, I help them. You're a great person, a great listener, and I bet you're the best dad ever. You know how to make people smile, and if I had a dad, I would want him to be just like you.
That's the first one. I cry like a baby. Let me say, every time y'all write me letters to the kids in the church, I sit down, I'm like a little punk, and I just cry. I do. But okay, I'm sorry.
Okay. Dear Mr. Dixon. No, this is a different person.
No, you read this.
Oh. Have I read it? Yes.
Oh, okay.
Dear Mr. Dixon, thank you for taking time out your schedule to talk to me about my career choices and my future. You may not know this, but you kind of just a little bit persuaded me not to be an exotic dancer. But there's more. Even though I still want to be one, I might actually go to college for business and run my own club.
Amen. Hey, but listen.
Amen.
I'm almost done, but here's the thing, though. Here's the thing about a mother or a father. See, God has given us the ability to see someone, not for where they are, but where they're going.
Amen.
Hear me when I say that. To see somebody, not for where they are, but where they're going. To see somebody, not for what they're doing right now, but what they're going to be doing in the future. And I joke about it all the time. I told her, the first time she said that in the class, I said, baby, I hope you get paid a lot of money. She said, oh, thank you. I said, in quarters, nickels, and dimes. She said, do you realize they're going to be throwing that money at me? I said, yep, and I hope it hurt. I said, I hope they don't make it rain. I
I want a hailstorm of money, Lord. I said, that way you get off there quick and you'll never go back. She said, you just wishing that. I said, no. I said, you still get paid. But over the years, I began to tell her things like, you know, you're smart. You're special. You're going to be something one day. You're going to be beautiful. You're going to be this. You're going to be that. You're going to be whatever. And everything wasn't about the way she looked. And so now she's starting to believe, maybe instead of me doing all this, maybe I can make money a better way. Now, she's still a little off right now. But we're working on that. Hear me when I say this, because one of the things that a mother does, or one of the things that a parent does, is they believe the best for their children. They believe the best for their children. And listen, they will fight for it. I can't count the amount of times that I've seen mothers on the floor groveling for their children. And their children come up. Look, I've seen mothers grab their child. The altar's not opening. No, you will get your, come on, you're going to get this prayer. But listen, I want you to honor your mother. I'm almost done. Matter of fact, I want you to stand. Honor your mother. Listen, I need you to understand this. If you don't understand anything else, through all the joking, through all the this, through all the that, that the name of God is growing. And God wouldn't put a baby in your spirit. Or God wouldn't put a baby in your stomach. God wouldn't put a baby in your life if he did not want it to grow and become what he's called it to be. Are you hearing what I'm saying? God would not put a ministry or something on the inside of you if he didn't plan on fulfilling it. God wouldn't send you somewhere for you to fail. Listen, your delays are not God's denials. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Other people may turn you down. Other people may disappoint you. But God will never do that. Listen, if God said you're going to graduate from college, you're going to graduate from college. If God said you're going to do this, you're going to do that. If God says you're going to be a leader, you're going to be a leader. If God said, listen, if God told you something about your child, do not let go until you see what it represents.
Amen.
I got a friend, a brother I talked to not too long ago. When he was in school, they said he was special. You know how you rich? No, they said he was special. They said he had all special ed, IEP, all that other stuff, you name it. And they said he would never be able to do this, never be able to do that. That man has a master's degree and working on a doctorate now. Why? Because they chose to believe the report of the Lord. Mm-hmm. Who told you that what you're carrying on the inside of you wasn't going to work? Mm-hmm. I guess I'm talking to myself now, too, because mm-hmm. I've been having some issues with some things. God says, who told you that? He's going to finish it. 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 Some of you are believing God for some things. Some of you are believing God for some people. God says, I will finish it. I will finish it. And some of you, you're already starting to see some of the fruit. God says, I will finish what I started. And I'm strengthening you. I know that you may seem to have a barren situation. And I don't know what stage you are in this thing. God said, I want you to ask me for something. He said, one of the reasons why I've been withholding that thing from you is because your sights have been too low. Mm-hmm. Somebody told you that you weren't worthy. He says, your sights are too low. Your sights are too low. He says, I want you to raise your sights. I want you to raise your sights. I want you to raise your sights. Mm-hmm. Some of you are asking for a neighborhood blessing when he wants you to affect the world. That hurt. What had happened was, God said, I want you to ask me for the impossible. I want you to believe in me. I want you to believe in me. God said, it's bigger than just you. It's bigger than just you.
bigger than just you.
Thank you, God.
It's bigger than just you.
Thank you, Lord.
It's bigger than just you. It's bigger than just you. I break every generational curse that's in this room. I break every negative thought that's in this room. God says, no matter who hurts you, God says, you are more than enough. Some of you are struggling with your next level because you can't forgive yourself for the mistakes you made in the past. But God said the battle is not over your past, it's over your future. And God said, through your worship, God says, I will deliver you. God says, begin to open up your mouth. Some of you have been struggling with things. God says your worship will break the bondages that's been over your life. God says begin to release from the fountains of your spirit. God says begin to release it. God says begin to open up your mouth. You shall declare a thing and it will be so, for the light will shine in your path. There are people in this room, they speak to people. I don't care if they're little people. They speak to people and to things. And God says you see them move already. But you think it's only on a minor level. God says, speak to the things, even on the biggest level, and you'll begin to see them move. The things that you're speaking to now are practice for the things that you'll speak to in the future. So begin to pray. Begin to pray. Begin to pray. Funny how you could take a little lady. She can be 4 foot tall, 4 foot five, and she can birth something 6 foot seven. It's bigger than you think it's going to be. It's bigger than you think it's going to be. It's funny how you can have something at one level. And then you look at it the next, and it's way bigger. I'm looking at my sister, Keisha. She had Isaiah, but not Isaiah looking like he wanted to be her daddy. It's a strength thing. The things that you birth will make room for you. And so I pray over everything that you birth, or everything that you're about to birth, every business, every major thing, every child. I speak it. There may be somebody in this room who believe in God for a child, but you think you can't have one. I speak right now that the devil is a lie. I hear fertile. 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 Fertile! I'm not going to embarrass you or anything like that, but there's an anointing on the ladies in this church. If there's an area in your life and you're a lady and you feel that you are unable to have a child, even if it's physically, I want you to find one of the ladies in this room. And I'm telling you, there's an anointing on each and every one of their lives. They will release a blessing over you. Listen, ask the person beside you. You don't have to pray for them right now. You don't have to pray for them right now. But before you leave this room, ladies, if there's an area in your life where you feel infertile, find one of the sisters in this room. And I pray a blessing over them to release it. We break it right now in the name of Jesus. Listen, if you are a male in this room and you feel like that your dreams have been put on hold or canceled, find someone in this room and they're going to pray over you. God's deferrals are not his no's. Hear me. The Bible says he opens doors that no man can shut. And he shuts doors that no man can open. I know your works. Listen, And I hear him saying, I'm going to set before you an open door and no man can shut it. So if that's you, if you feel like your dreams have been put on hold, and maybe you might be struggling with depression, God says, I'm telling you to find someone. Listen, if that's you, find someone. We're going to close. But I want everybody to reach and grab the person beside you. Grab the person beside you. And just repeat after me. God bless the hands, I hope.
We open up.
Give us what you want us to have.
Give us what you want us to have.
We break infertility over this congregation.
We break infertility over this congregation.
We break spiritual infertility.
We break spiritual infertility.
We break financial infertility.
We break financial infertility.
And we break physical infertility.
We break physical infertility.
We break mental infertility.
We break mental infertility.
Father, we bless you. God, I pray over each and every person in this room that you would give them what they desire and what your desire is for them, God. I pray, Father God, that you would break every negative thought, God, every negative line, God. I pray it right now. I pray it right now. I pray it right now. In the name of Jesus, I speak life over every person in this room. I speak it right now. You are worthy. You're more than enough. 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 You are not worthless. You are not ugly. You are not. You are beautiful in the sight of the Lord. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. You are a child of the King. You are a daughter of Zion. You are a princess. You are royalty. I break every negative word that the enemy has ever spoken over you. I break it right now. I break every heartbreak. You will be free to love and free to give. I break every negative touch, every negative thought, every negative word, everyone who puts you down. I break it right now in the name of Jesus. We break it. We break every time you've ever been stabbed in the back. We break it right now. 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 Listen, the enemy desires to hold you back. Because he knows that if you ever let up, that you would break his kingdom in half. We break it right now. Right now. Right now. I bind every negative word, every generation of bondage. I bind every negative thought. Who told you you weren't fearfully and wonderfully made? Who told you you weren't created in my image? Who told you that you weren't special? Who told you that you weren't a queen? Who told you that you weren't my child? Who told you that you weren't me? Who told you that you would never be anything? Who told you that? I say that you are daughter of Zion, that you are an Esther, that you are Ruth, that you are on the order of Naomi, that you are a princess, that you are a daughter of Zion, that you are a lion dweller, and that the enemy would seek to hinder you because he knows that you are my precious possession, my beautiful weapon of war. No weapon formed against you will be able to prosper. Now break the negative spell that's been over your mind. You will achieve. You will achieve.
You will be more than enough. You. You'll be more than enough. Your season of breakthrough is here. You'll be more than enough. 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 I break it right now in the name of Jesus. We're almost done. I break it right now in the name of Jesus. I break it right now in the name of Jesus. Squeeze that hand. There's somebody in this business. The Lord is using you to leave breadcrumbs. See, one of the reasons why your life was so jacked up initially, there's a person in this room. I know one of them. But the reason why the Lord has been doing things slowly in you is because there's somebody that's attached to you who would never see their way out of bondage. But they're able to look at you and see breadcrumbs. Breadcrumbs of deliverance. See, because a little while ago, you were worse off than they were, but now they look at you and they see you getting better. They see you doing this. They see you going to school. They see you doing this. They see you doing whatever it is. They see you being delivered. They see you living a better life. And even though they may have nitpicked at you, they see you doing better, and you're convicting them of where God is calling them to eventually go. And what you're doing is God is using your life as breadcrumbs. Father, we break the back of the enemy. God, we say, have your way. Have your way, have your way, have your way. Have your way, have your way. Have your way, have your way. Have your way. Why some things aren't fitting is because there's too much that's attached to the piece. And so what God is doing right now, I know we're going to get out of here, but listen, what God is doing right now is God is cleaning up the puzzle piece so that you'll fit. So that you'll fit. So that things are fitting your marriage, so that things are fitting your relationship, so that things are fitting your finances. God is scraping away some of the stuff that was attached to you so that speak life over you. We speak life over your people. We say that you'll be blessed in the city and blessed in the field. Blessed whenever you come and whenever you go. I pray that your enemies will come at you one way but flee in seven. On this Mother's Day, we speak a special blessing over you. The Bible says he rejoices over us like a hen brooding over her chicks. And so I pray that the Lord would watch over you. I pray that his spirit would grow on the inside of you so deep that it would erase every negative thought.
speak life over it. In the name of Jesus. Listen, we're going to continue to pray, but if you have to go, amen. Amen. But listen, don't forget, if there's an area in your life where you feel like you've been barren, I want you to grab something.